Thank you very much. Our next speaker hardly needs an introduction. Horst Bredekamp joins us from the Humboldt Universität in Berlin. Please welcome Horst Bredekamp.
Good morning. After completing a doctorate in art history in Bonn in the summer semester of 1892, Aby Warburg transferred to Berlin University. A short time after the beginning of the semester, he sent a letter to the editor of the Nationalzeitung, an organ of liberalism in Germany, in which the Hamburg native's dislike of Berlin is heard. In this letter, Warburg was up in arms about the supporters of Reichstag delegate Hermann Ahlwardt, whose anti-Semitic rebel rousing culminated in the reproach that the Jewish arms manufacturer Ludwig Löwe supplied the German army with unservable weapons. This slander was so untenable that Albert was later tried in court. Warburg called on the newspaper to do more to end the Jew baiting of Albert's supporters on Friedrichstrasse, which you see here, or that it called on the police to take measures against them for blocking traffic. If this doesn't happen, the letter ends, then it would appear to me that Germany is in trouble. If the rescuers of German morals and Germany's martial security had to be found in these market criers in the gutters of Friedrichstrasse. The 26-year-old proclaims his contempt also by signing, not with his name, but with a Hanseatic man. All of this might lead us to suspect that the city of Berlin and its influence on Warburg could be a theme only negatively. In his saying, Jew by birth, Hamburger by heart, Florentine in spirit, appear the points between which he is rightly situated, a German Jew, a Hanseatic Hamburger, a Florentine Renaissance man. That Berlin played a role of its own was not a theme until now. But the large number of visits Warburg made to the capital of the Reich shows that Berlin was hardly an unimportant reference point. To the extent that I can surmise with the aid of Thomas Helbig and Stefan Haug, who edited the collected letters, Warburg was in Berlin for short visits or even for weeks and months, a total of 36 times between 1890 and 1928. He lodged in grand hotels like the Hotel de Rome, Carlton, Bristol, Fürstenhof, and the legendary Hotel Adlon, where the Kaiser had his love affairs. Without a doubt, the choice of this form of accommodations was shaped by the conviction that he should not let his art historical activities be considered subordinate to bank business. His status was that of the firstborn of an important banker family, and he claimed it also and precisely as an art historian. Second point, reorientation towards ethnology. The traces of Warburg's appearances in Berlin are mostly blurred, including his studies in 1892 with the psychologist Hermann Ebbinghaus, whose habilitation, Über das Gedächtnis, about memory, is still regarded as the fundamental text of experimental psychology. As indicated yesterday in the discussion, it would be worth investigating the degree to which traces of it can be found in Warburg's concept of mnemosyne. The first component of a tie to Berlin, however, was that here he could pursue the impetus he had received by encountering the Hopi Indians in 1895-96. On July 1896, he sent a letter from Berlin to the ethnologist Franz Boas, 8 years his senior, who can be seen in a photograph taken around the same time in the pose of a Kwaitul Hamata dancer. Warburg maintained contact all of his life with Boas, who remained committed to the legacy of Gottfried Herder and Alexander von Humboldt after emigration to the United States in 1887, and who is today considered the father of modern ethnology. Referring to a meeting in 1895, Warburg reports on his studies of the antiquities of Mexico and Peru in the Royal Museum for Ethnology, the museum of the important ethnologist Adolf Bastian, which was opened in 1886 on ground between Potsdamer Platz and Leipziger Platz in Berlin. A list of the researchers whom Warburg refers to as collaborating with or in contact with him reads like a who's who of the field of ethnology of the time. You see from left above clockwise, Henry Richard Vogt, Jesse Walker Fuchs, William Niven, Eduard Georg Seeler, and Karl von den Steinen. The especially intense correspondence with Fuchs culminated in Warburg's statement that it was high time for both the Mexican antiquities and the still living Pueblo Indians. I quote, "Every interruption or delay of this kind damages science extraordinary." Here we hear the same vehemence that Karl von den Steinen noted as Bastian's basic drive to collect ethnological objects of all kinds. The last moment, the 12th hour, has arrived. Documents of immeasurable, irreplaceable value for the history of human mankind are being destroyed. Rescue, rescue, before it's too late, end quote. Warburg's participation in this effort culminated in his wish to write a habilitation thesis in this field. In a 27 February 1897 letter to the Kiel philologist Hermann Oldenburg, he announced his plan. This utterance shows the degree to which Warburg was captivated by the pictorial and dance culture of the Hopi Indians after he had encountered similar problems with his dissertation on Botticelli. Thus, Warburg's shifting focus of his life to Berlin in the years 1896 and 97 had to do with his plans to write a habilitation thesis on the culture of the Hopi Indians. This academic interest led Warburg to join the Berlin Society for Anthropology, Ethnology, and Prehistory in the spring of 1897. His striving to submit the theme of his research led him, after presentations in Hamburg, to give a lecture on 17th March 1897 before the Free Photographic Union in Berlin. The title is Pictures from the Life of the Pueblo Indians in North America. In the following year, Warburg worked on a publication compiling his studies of the Humiscachina dance. Although Warburg thereafter returned to European themes, his interest in ethnology never completely left his focus in the following years, especially since in April 1896 he had collected and himself created drawings in Indian territory that were shown in exhibitions on research on children's drawings, first in Hamburg in 1899, and then in 1901 in the building of the Berlin Secession in Berlin, of course. At the major Berlin Conference for Aesthetic and General Art History of 1913, additional drawings by Indian children of his collection were exhibited. At the Kreuzlinger Sanatorium did the theme that had tied him to Berlin in a special way return like a revenant. And indeed, Warburg used notes and materials from the article he had penned in 1897 in Berlin to prepare his lecture. In Kreuzlingen, he called his attempt the famous quotient, the dreadful twitching of a decapitated frog. It was the jolt of this theme that revived him again, so to speak. More than 25 years earlier, in Warburg's Berlin period, the euphoria that took possession of him in his research on the topic of his journey in America is visible in a letter written on 27th March 1897. It clearly displays where this capacity came from. Husarenstimmung, Hussar mood, California, sullen Prussianism has made way. With Husarenstimmung, Hussar mood, Warburg means exuberance. Suddenly, Berlin was the emotional arena of a Wild West ride. Third point, scientific exchange, Adolf Goldschmidt. The elation emerging here was also based in the sometimes greater resonance Warburg found in Berlin than in Hamburg. The favorable reception of his research goes back as far as his dissertation. Hermann Grimm, since 1873 professor for art history at the Berlin University, he was famous for his biography of Michelangelo, in which he projected the pathos of freedom of the failed 1848 revolution onto Renaissance Florence as a kind of utopia of Berlin. Grimm published a thoroughly positive review of Warburg's dissertation in June 1893. Adolf Goldschmidt had drawn Grimm's attention to Warburg's study. In the same year, Goldschmidt had earned his habilitation under Grimm at Berlin's university with an inaugural lecture on Michelangelo. Like Warburg, Goldschmidt was the scion of a Jewish banker family in Hamburg. After holding a private lectureship at Berlin University, beginning in 1904, he taught as a full professor for art history in Halle, returning to Berlin in 1912 as the successor to Heinrich Wölflin, who then went to Munich. Even before 1892, Warburg and Goldschmidt had had encounters whose thread they could take up in Berlin. Goldschmidt's lifelong esteem for the Berlin Impressionist Max Liebermann was shared by Warburg. Recently, my colleague Stefan Trinks, who is present in this conference, has published a superb analysis of Goldschmidt's influence on Warburg regarding the medieval ages. Well, in my title you saw Berlin, Warburg Berlin and the medieval ages. So I cut this off because this article is sufficient. And I do this all the more as also Betsy Sears is touching upon it, I guess. But I would like to refer to an event that was mentioned yesterday. Goldschmidt's friendship with Albert Einstein developed through the Prussian Academy of Sciences, and Goldschmidt was probably the one who mediated Warburg's visit to Einstein in his summer home in Scharbeutz in September 1928. On this occasion, Einstein made the sketch for Warburg that Claudia Wedepol found in the Warburg archive. This was what led us to write a book together on this theme that came out last year. As to yesterday's discussion, and this has not just to do with my theme, but without Goldschmidt, you wouldn't have encountered Einstein, I guess. And I would once again underline that Warburg's view of Kepler, he exposed to Einstein, composed by the bipolarity of reason and occultism, came closer to the historical reality than Einstein's more linear concept of the scientific development. Today, Warburg's view is out of doubt. Of inestimable importance was that Warburg could meet among Goldschmidt's students, his own kind of student, Karl Georg Kaiser, Erwin Panofsky, and Hans Kaufmann. A famous photo shows Goldschmidt in a group of students, among them Panofsky here on the outer right. Warburg met this group for the first time on 9th November 1915 in Berlin, and on 28th December a return visit was made in the Warburg Library in Hamburg. This meeting was significant for the further development of art history as we know, in that here the nucleus came together that in the 1920s created the fame of the Hamburg School that would continue exerting influence via the Warburg Institute here in London in the USA after 1933. Betsy Sears will talk about this photography and what stood behind more lengthily. Warburg and Goldschmidt shared the mania for meticulousness about detail, which in Goldschmidt was honed by a veritably haptic precision of view, by natural scientific models, but also by the tradition of connoisseurship and the combination of criminology and form analysis. A high point of the collaboration between Warburg and Goldschmidt must have been the double lecture they gave together on 11th December 1903 at the Art Historical Society of Berlin on Rogier van der Weyden's deposition and the comparison with Michelangelo. Fourth point, specialized interest in science policy, Wilhelm von Bode. From 1902 to 1908, Warburg took regular part in the meetings of the Berlin Art Historical Society, the already mentioned Kunstgeschichtliche Gesellschaft, which sought to bring the world of museums together with other fields of art historical work. This brought Warburg together also with Wilhelm von Bode. Along with a common interest in the art history of the Renaissance, Warburg and Bode were tied by science policy. In a letter to his brother Max, Aby Warburg, looking back on his life, characterized himself not so much as a reflector, but as a, quote, politician. You never really inwardly wanted to grant that I am a politician. The cliché, that a humanities scholar is not the right director for the practical things of this world is still lodged solidly, if not entirely, in you. But now, in the hour of my death, I would like to say, like Nero, what a politician dies in me. Warburg explained his ironic reversal of the saying attributed to Nero, what an artist dies in me, with the thought that his goal in founding the Warburg Library in Hamburg was to defend the freedom of research against all state institutions. Berlin offered a special stage for this aim. Here, where the Prussian state organized itself, Warburg sought to assert his principle of independent research. Bode was one of the reference points of this attitude. He understood better than anyone else how to steer the sheer immeasurable wealth that had formed in the city since Germany's unification into the museums on the model of Florence. He shaped his own creation, the Bode Museum, like an ideal Florentine church in an echo of San Salvatore e San Francesco al Monte. Whenever Warburg learned that an interesting art collection was offered for sale, he informed Bode. In the summer of 1904, Warburg hung in veneration a lithographic portrait of Bode in his workroom. Bode and Warburg cooperated above all in the field of science policy. Their common interest was strongest in the German Cultural Historical Institute in Florence. During the war, their focus was on this institute housed in the Palazzo Guadagni, which led Warburg to take repeated trips to Berlin to confer with Bode in the framework of their activity in the association to preserve the Cultural Historical Institute in Florence. Warburg told the great historian Robert Davidson in December 1914 that he and Bode would ensure the KHI's independence. Bode guaranteed political support for the Florentine Institute, in which his context Warburg, in his function as a member of the association already mentioned to preserve the Cultural Historical Institute, would be delegated to Italy to be able, quote, in the improbable case of rupture between Italy and Germany, to place the institute under the protection of a neutral power, end quote. In Warburg's letter of 1st of August 1914, congratulating Bode on his 40th anniversary in his position underscores this division of roles. Quote, I hope that you yourself can continue to ensure contact with Italy for a long time to come. While Warburg worked tirelessly to found a university in Hamburg, his engagement for the Florentine Institute was unshakably tied to Berlin. Fifth, the Luther theme. Finally, Warburg's lecture at a meeting of the Religious Studies Association on 23rd April 1918 must have been one of his grandest experiences in Berlin. His elucidations expanded on his Hamburg lecture of fall 1917 on how the ancient pagan prophecies were seen in Luther's times. This theme was one of the consequences of the impossibility of carrying on his Italian research because of the war with Italy and the closing of the Florentine Institute. With Luther and the image politics of the Reformation, the lectures now centered on a German theme bearing the seeds of a fundamental history of pictorial political propaganda, which can be seen, of course, also as a founding act of media science. Astrology and the era of Luther, who rejected this practice of seeking knowledge, also gave Warburg the opportunity to present the permanent and ubiquitous bipolarity between reason and superstition that he later saw developed in its heroic form in Johannes Kepler, as I mentioned. Although Ernst Troitsch was not in Berlin and therefore was as unable as Max Dessoir as to attend, Warburg encountered an illustrious audience. Mary Herz Warburg was impressed, arguing that you would never have had such an impressive auditorium in Berlin. All of this, is it of only regional interest? In my view, if I'm not wrong, it has more than that. It has a kind of paradigmatic character. It shows the infinite desire to reflect, but also to save and to act and shape in the sense of vita activa, thus demonstrating the telos of the humanities, which should play out their intellectual and political destination and the price that is to pay for it. We thus come to the last point, the conclusion, ambivalent Berlin. Abby's brother Max, like Berlin, Simon, and the brothers Rathenau, members of the so-called Imperial Jews, the Kaiserjuden, who had unlimited and immediate access to the Kaiser, they shaped this inner circle. Aby Warburg belonged at least mentally to the outer circle of this in-group. It is all the more astounding that Aby Warburg praised Hugo Lederer's Bismarck Tower monument, majestically heading the Hamburg harbor. His praise is stylistic. He defends the modernity of its form in 1906 against the narrative monuments of 19th century. But there was a political tone between the lines. Bismarck had become a symbol of Hanseatic resistance and pride against the sense of supremacy directed from Berlin. Bismarck had become a victim of the Kaiser's politics, mainly on social fields, after the resistance of Bismarck against the emperor's politics against the social democrats, his resignation was accepted on 20th March 1890. In his fragments on expression, which took the form also of a diary, Warburg noted this sequence of events. This presents the greatest possible contrast to the Hanseatic man's 1892 letter to the editor of the Nationalzeitung that I quoted at the beginning. 5 years after this letter, interrupted by his travels in America, Warburg found a circle of people in Berlin that at that time he could have encountered only in this city, ethnologist. The openness of ethnology, of religious studies, and no least of his own discipline, as he found it in his friendly relations with Adolf Goldschmidt, the interplay between museum and university and the kunstgeschichtliche Gesellschaft, then the opportunities of science policy, which extended as far as Florence. All of this worked together to enable Warburg to experience many happy moments, which were seldom enough despite his Hanseatic distaste for the dominant and often arrogant capital of the Reich. In 1897, he reported on his Husarenstimmung, and in 1918, on the eve of his emotional breakdown, he regarded this city as a fountain of youth. All of this makes Berlin, after Hamburg, New Mexico, and Florence, appear as the fourth place that decisively shaped Warburg. In all the antagonistic ambivalence characteristic of the time and of Warburg himself. Thank you.